and we were just looking at a 1D crystal. With periodic boundary conditions. So basically, this is a ring because it's periodic boundary conditions. I'm sorry, this is so bad. So these are the sites. And the site 1 is here, site N is here, this is site 2, site 3, and so on. Okay, so is the screen also visible to everyone?
Yes,
Yes,
sir.
sir. Yes.
Okay, thank you. Right, so we had started with looking at the potential energy of this system and the potential energy in terms of the spring constant. So this is a oscillator model of a 1D crystal, an oscillator model of a 1D crystal. Okay, so the potential energy V is given by half K of UN minus UN plus 1 squared. So given this, we can find out what is the force, right? The force on the nth atom is basically Fn is minus del V by del UN, right? So if you do this properly, then what you would see is the Newton's law. I mean, using the Newton's law, we can derive the equation of motion. And that turns out to be m times un double dot is minus k 2un minus un minus 1 minus un plus 1. And in the last class, we had looked at the full matrix structure of this. And using the matrix structure, we had argued that because there are n atoms in this crystal, there will be n equations. Okay. And because there are n equations, it means if we do a simple Fourier transform, so let's say un of t is some un tilde, which is independent of time, and e to the power minus or plus I omega t. And if we substitute this here, then this entire set of equations reduces to a homogeneous linear equations set. Okay. A set of homogeneous linear equations. All right, and the solution of this leads to n roots of the characteristic polynomial. And those n roots imply these n roots imply that there are n possible frequencies for this 1D crystal. So remember, when we talk about n possible frequencies, then this n possible frequencies are for this entire crystal. Okay, and we had seen some examples of what are the possible modes of vibration of one oscillator, two oscillator, three oscillators, four oscillators, up to five, right? And then I had also shown you that suppose you had a full 1D crystal, then what would the lowest eigen modes look like, or what would the lowest normal modes look like? Okay, and remember, this is a fully classical derivation, right? There is no quantum mechanics that has been invoked until now. So basically, we started with a full quantum mechanical model involving atoms, nuclei, and everything. Then what we did was we used the Born-Oppenheimer approximation and isolated or made the electrons and the nuclei independent. In fact, the electrons were dependent on the positions of the nuclei, and we derived or we show we discussed how to derive an electronic potential energy surface, and that we then did a Taylor's expansion and got a harmonic approximation for the crystal. Now, once we get all that, we should remember that it's actually a quantum Hamiltonian. Okay. But it turns out that if you just take that Hamiltonian, right, and look at the spirit of that Hamiltonian and say that, okay, all this is describing is a set of coupled harmonic oscillators. Let me now do a fully classical treatment of a coupled oscillator system and see what I get, right? So it turns out what we get is exactly what you would get out of a quantum treatment as far as the normal modes is concerned, right? Now, how you deal with those normal modes in writing down the partition function and writing down the response functions or the thermodynamic quantities is a different issue. But the normal modes, as far as a classical system is concerned or a quantum system is concerned, the normal modes are exactly the same. Okay, so this is a very interesting and intriguing fact. Okay, so the classical derivation itself gives you n possible frequencies. Okay, and but how you take these frequencies forward, and then what about the eigen modes, right? See, until now we have not focused on the u n deltas, right? We have only focused on the omegas, and we found that there are n possible values of omega squared, right? Now let's do one more thing. Let's just go ahead and see what happens to this entire system in K space. Okay. So remember, this is a periodic system. And again, the periodic system means that there should be a Fourier series form should be possible. This is what we discussed for crystallography also, right? So this set of linear equations should be diagonalizable in a different space. Okay, so what do I mean by that? Let me explain this. Okay, so the equation of motion that we had written in real space was this: m u n dot is k times minus k times 2 u n minus u n minus 1 minus u n plus 1. And what we had discussed using this was that if we use u n equal to u n tilde e to the power I omega t, then we get a matrix. Okay, this entire system of equations can be written down in terms of a matrix, and that matrix was a tri-banded matrix. It had the diagonal which was non-zero, and one off diagonal and another off diagonal which was non-zero, and because it's periodic boundary conditions, at the very two corners there is a spring constant which is sitting. Okay. Now, this matrix, it's easy to see, is not a diagonal matrix. Okay? And because it is not a diagonal matrix, if you want to get its eigenvalues, then you have to diagonalize it. Right? You have to find its characteristic polynomial. Okay? But this kind of a non-diagonal matrix, where does it come from? It comes directly from the equation itself. So if you look at the equation, then the un is connected not only to un itself, but it's also connected to un minus 1 and un plus 1, right? So this is where the off diagonal part is coming from. And you can see these off diagonal, the off diagonal bands, they are basically coming because the uns are coupled in real space to un minus 1 and un plus 1, okay? So now the question is, can I move to a different space? Okay, so this is all in real space. Can I move to a different space where I can see, where I can diagonalize this matrix? Okay, so I want to move to a different space where this is a diagonal matrix. And it turns out this is possible, right? And the real space matrix, which is off diagonal, becomes a diagonal matrix in K space. Okay, so let us see how that happens. And this is a very general fact. In fact, this is what happens in most differential equations also. If you have a full differential equation, which is a partial differential equation in real space, and if you go to K space, you can actually diagonalize it, which means it becomes an algebraic equation. Okay, partial differential equations are off diagonal in real space because if you have a derivative of some function in real space, right, then you can write it as f of x plus h minus f of x by, so which means that f of, so, and if this is connected to some, if this is a functional of f of x, then you can see that at the x point is also connected to x plus h and x, So that's why this is a off diagonal equation. Okay, but if you now go back to, if you now transform this entire equation to k space, it will turn out that every k point is connected only to the same k point and not to other k points. Okay, and if that happens, then this entire equation is a diagonal equation, right? So that's what we will see in this case also. We will take this equation, this set of equations, and then write them down in k space. So how do we do that? We do a simple transformation. Until now, we have done only the time transformation. Let's do the real space transformation also. Remember the index n here, the un, okay? This n actually corresponds to a real space site index. And this real space site index runs from 1 to n. All right. So the un can be written as some ak times e to the power I k n a minus omega t. So let's take this ansatz. Okay. So this is an ansatz, or a guess, in other words, and then substitute this into the main equation. If we do that, then what do we get? So un double dot is basically the time derivative, 2 times time derivative. So we will get minus m omega squared ak e to the power I k n a minus omega t. And this becomes minus capital K 2 times ak, and e to the power I k n a minus omega t remains as it is. So this remains as it is. Now let's see what happens to un minus 1. So when I substitute un minus 1, then n has to be n minus 1 here. But then that minus 1 a, I can take it out and write this as following. Minus ak e to the power I k n a minus omega t multiplied by e to the, yeah.
Sir, when we add a Fourier transformation, we basically sum over the k value. If correct. I, if we, so here we are not getting sum over. So why this is happening?
Sure. So excellent question. So what we are doing here is we are assuming that there is a certain relation between the omega and the k. Okay. And what we want to do is to basically find out that relation. Basically, we want to find the dispersion of that. And what we are saying is that there are certain
norms. I cannot hear you, sir.
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Sir, I could. Yeah.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. All I'm saying is that you're right that what I should be doing is to take a Fourier series and then find out what possible values there are of the Fourier series. Okay. But what happens is you can try doing this, right? These e to the power I k n a's, they are all orthogonal to each other. Okay. And if the number of sides is large, only in the thermodynamic limit, these all of these e to the power I k n a's are orthogonal to each other. And if they are orthogonal to each other, then each of them behaves as an independent mode. Okay. So this is essentially what is happening here. So I didn't want to complicate the situation. Okay. But just send me a test mail and I will send you some notes. Okay, where the entire Fourier series can be used in order to derive the same dispersion relations, and that follows from the orthogonality relations of the e to the power I k n a. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So and then the last term will become e the same thing k n a minus omega t, and we will get an extra e to the power I k a. Okay, so what this tells us is that if the ak is non-zero, right, which we don't want it to be zero, then this entire thing cancels off. And all we get from here is minus m omega squared is minus k times 2 minus these two. If I add up, I will get a 2 cos ka. Okay, so this tells me that omega squared is k by m, or 2k by m into 2 sine squared ka by 2. Okay, so let me erase this. So let me write that last relation once again. Omega squared is k by m, 4k by m, sine squared ka by 2. Okay. So this is known as the dispersion relation for the lattice vibrations. All right. Now, if this is given to us, then let's try to find out what is the phase velocity and what is the group velocity. So, what is phase velocity given by?
Omega by k.
Omega by k, correct. So, let's call it V5. That is just omega by k. So this is saying that if you take the phase e to the power I k x minus omega t, then you can see here that there is an x and there is a t, right? So, and this is basically the phase. Okay. So you can see that if I take the k out, I will get x minus omega by k into t. So if I take the k common, I'll get x minus omega by k into t, right? So this here is the phase velocity. This entire thing is the phase, right? This entire thing is the phase, and this is the phase velocity. So let's call this V5. So V5 is omega by k. Now what is the group velocity?
D omega by dk.
D omega by dk. So let's call this d omega by dk. All right. Now, if I simply take omega by k, then you can see that it's not going to be any simple expression. In the sense that there is the k is sitting inside the sine squared, and unless I do a Taylor's expansion of the sine squared ka, I will not get anything meaningful. Okay, so let's do a k tending to 0 calculation for the phase velocity. What we should get is omega squared is 4 capital K by m a by 2 whole squared. So this would tell us 4 k by m, and the 4 will cancel, k squared a squared by 4. So omega itself is, so if I just take the omega, then I will get root k by m and then mod k a. So this would mean that if I take the omega by k, then that would be root k by m times mod a. So this tells you that there is a certain phase velocity which is well defined for the k tending to 0. But if I take k non-zero, then it's going to be a complicated expression. However, the group velocity is extremely well defined. And if I again restrict myself to k greater than 0, then it's easy to write omega is equal to root 4k by m sine k a by 2. And we can figure out the group velocity also just by doing del omega by del k. Okay, so that is root 4 k by m a by 2 cos k a by 2. So the question is, what is all this telling us? Okay, if you see here, this is very interesting. The k tending to 0 phase velocity does not actually depend on the k at all, okay, on the momentum at all. Similarly, here also, it's the same story. If I take the k tending to 0 limit and expand this to linear order, then the cos has an expansion which is 1 minus k squared a squared by 4. So which means to the lowest order, I can take this as 1. And if I take this as 1, then in the limit k tending to 0, I again get the same thing as I got here, which is root k by m times a. So which means that the phase velocity and the group velocity are independent of the momentum as k tends to 0. And the existence of a well-defined velocity and an energy, right, and an energy momentum relation prompts us to call these as particles, like phonons. Okay, and phonons, you can see, are similar sounding to baryons, protons, neutrons, electrons, which are considered to be particles. But we know that these are not particles in the usual sense. These are all collective excitations. The entire crystal is taking part in producing one such lattice vibration, one such mode. Choose one such frequency here, right? And that is equal. Yeah.
Hello.
Yes,
sir.
Yes.
I am extremely sorry. I could not hear you again for few seconds.
Okay. Yeah, I was just saying that the existence of a well-defined relation between the omega and k, between 1k and 1 omega, implies that we could call these as particles, normal particles like electrons, protons, neutrons, and so on. Then there is a well-defined relation between their wavelength and the energy. Okay, using the de Broglie relation, you can take the wavelength, convert that to momentum, and if it's a free particle, then it's just p squared by 2m. Okay, but even if it is not a free particle and moving in some, let's say, crystal potential, even then you can assign it some sort of an energy. So if it has a well-defined energy and a well-defined momentum, we tend to call it a particle or a particle. So in that sense, we could call these normal modes that we have just now derived as particles, right? But what we need to understand is that even though we can treat them like particles mathematically, physically they don't arise as a particle. They are actually distributed over the entire crystal. The power 23 atoms are participating in creating one normal mode. Normal modes, where n is the number of atoms in the crystal. So each normal mode is contributed atoms in the crystal, right? So that's very important to remember. And one more thing that will help you to understand this is that if you go back to the set of linear equations that we had written and try to solve the linear equations for all the u values, for all the u1, u2, u3 and so on, those are basically the eigenvectors. So we found the eigenvalues, but you can also find the eigenvectors. And those eigenvectors were what I had shown you in the previous class as the motion. See, remember those, the amplitude of the vibration is basically given by the prefactor of the exponential, right? So let me just go back to that presentation and then discuss it from there. Yeah, if you see this, then each normal mode, right, one normal mode is contributed to by all the atoms in the lattice. It's not that there is one particle which is moving with a well-defined momentum and an energy. It just so happens that any general lattice vibration can be written down as a linear superposition of these normal modes. Okay, so that's what one has to understand. But the normal modes are like the eigenvalues of a normal quantum mechanical system. But remember, this is again a classical system. And even in a classical system, you can have normal modes. And the reason is very simple, actually. If you see, these are all waves, right? And there is a wave-particle duality in quantum mechanics. And as soon as you, ascribe the wave nature of to a particle, you can see all the wave-like effects like interference and diffraction and so on, right? So that's what is happening here, that you already have a wave, right? And because you have a wave, the kind of things that give you the eigenvalues, let's say in a particle in a box problem, that is, let's say if you had a particle in a box and then you want to find its eigenvalues, what you would say is, let's say I will find out the wavelength and find out how many wavelengths fit into that box, right? And using the uncertainty relation, you can actually derive what are the eigenvalues. So by looking at the wave nature of the electron, you can derive already from the uncertainty principle all the eigenvalues which are allowed. Similarly, here also, the phonons are already waves, right? So getting normal modes in a classical system is not very surprising, right? And it so happens that if you want to go to the quantum system now, then the same normal modes the same normal modes will appear in the eigenvalue analysis of the quantum mechanical problem. Okay, yeah.
Sir, I have a question.
Hello?
Yes, go on.
Hello? At temperature T equals to 0 Kelvin, there is no vibration actually. And if we increase the temperature of the system, the vibration arises and number of phonons increases. So you said that our phonon is basically our mode extended over all the crystal. So if we increase the temperature, people say that the number of phonons increase. So what the number of phonons means? Number of modes. How many modes can apply at a particular time?
Yeah, sure. So there are many things that you said. So first let's start with zero temperature. Okay. And you said that only phonons can only be excited at finite temperature, right? But suppose I do a hypothetical zero Kelvin experiment, and you are claiming now that there are no phonons. But if I do a mechanical perturbation to the system, let's say I provide an impulse to the system, okay, then even at zero temperature, I would find a vibration, right? Isn't that right?
Yes.
And all we are saying now is that all the atoms in the lattice would be vibrating, okay, would be oscillating about their equilibrium position. Now the question is, how is this energy that you have provided to the system, how does that get distributed among these normal modes? Okay, so if you are providing enough energy for certain number of normal modes to get occupied, okay, so that is then described by the Bose-Einstein distribution function. That is, a certain normal mode will be occupied or unoccupied with a certain probability. Okay, and then you can do one more thing, which is to provide precisely the energy of a certain normal mode. And then make sure that only that particular normal mode gets excited. So then you're populating by design that particular normal mode. But in a general real crystal, that's very hard to do. But you can do that in molecules. In molecules, there are, you know, well separated and well defined normal modes. So for example, if you take a coupled oscillator system, let's say three oscillators, you would only find three normal modes. And in these three normal modes, you will find that the frequencies are extremely different. Okay, they are widely separated. When they are widely separated, you can tune the incoming radiation. For example, you are using electromagnetic radiation to excite this molecule. You can tune the frequency precisely so that you excite only one of those vibrations. But how would you do that for a crystal? Remember, in a crystal, you have a continuum of vibrations. And the vibrations, not only they are in a continuum, there are also extremely low energy vibrations also in the system. Where are those low energy vibrations? You can see here. See, the omega is actually given by root k by m mod a times k. And k starts from zero, right? So this is telling you that there are extremely low energy modes also available in a crystal. And remember, these come from the Goldstone. These are actually the Goldstone modes, which we have got by breaking the continuous translational symmetry and reducing the system to a discrete translational symmetry. Okay. So in a crystal, we don't have well-defined, well-separated normal modes. They are in a continuum. Okay. So in a finite temperature, the distribution of energy or the occupancy of these modes is decided by the Bose-Einstein distribution. Now, how does one get to that? Okay, so one has to go back to the quantum mechanical Hamiltonian of the harmonic oscillators and then look at what are the operators that would diagonalize the quantum mechanical Hamiltonian. And those operators turn out to be the creation annihilation operators, which obey the Bose commutation relations, okay, the bosonic commutation relations. And because of that, we say that the phonons are bosons. So I'm not sure whether I answered your question, but you can rephrase the question if I have not answered it. Did my answer cover what you're looking for?
Yes, sir, it covered.
It covered. Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir, it covered very well.
All right. So, right. So, what we started with was UN is equal to AK. Yes. Was there any other question?
Yes, sir. I'm Krishna. Ah. Sir, you said that phonons have definite energy and momentum.
Yes.
So, how will we determine the energy?
How is it what?
How will we determine the energy by the amplitude of every oscillation? Or
I will tell you. Just hold on 1 minute. So, the periodic. Let me just finish this argument and then I'll go back to that. So the periodic boundary conditions, when you apply on this, then you will basically say that UN plus capital N should be equal to UN. That is, on this ring, if I take any particular N and then go to the N sites, okay, cover N sites, then I should come back to the same point, right? So which means that UN plus capital N should be the same as UN. And this, if I now apply to this expression, then I will get e to the power I k n a is equal to 1, which implies that k n a should be equal to 2 pi m, and this implies k should be equal to 2 pi m by n a. So these are the values that this can take, and you can either take m to be from 1 to n, right, or you can take m from minus n by 2 to n by 2. Okay, and this is generally a more used version. So this will tell you that k belongs to minus pi by a to pi by a. Okay, and this is a closed interval here and an open interval here, because it's things again become periodic. You can easily see that by substituting into this relation. Omega k is equal to, so we got 2 root k by m sine k a by 2. So if you substitute k plus 2 pi by a into this, you will get back again the omega k, right? So that's how you know that omega k is periodic with in this zone. So this is also the first Brillouin zone of the phonon dispersion, right? So Krishna, going back to your question, if you see this dispersion here, okay, then you see that for each k, there is a specific omega, that omega k that is defined. Okay. Now, this is precisely what does not happen if you had anharmonic terms. Okay. So, what happens is, if you had anharmonic terms, then the k does not Hello.
There is some connectivity issue. Your voice is breaking.
Oh, my voice is breaking. Okay. Let me see what I am connected to.
Your voice is breaking, sir. I could not hear properly.
Well, I'm connected to a good network, so I don't understand.
Hello.
It must be. Yeah, this must be the JNC network that is the problem then.
Sir, your network is fine. We are getting clearly. I think his network has some problem.
Hey Krishna, then it's your network. It's not mine. See, others can hear. How about the others? Can others hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So Krishna, you need to check your network. Okay. Don't make me feel guilty.
Yes.
This is a joke. Okay. Don't take it seriously. Anyway, so I'm just saying that in this particular case, we saw that the equations, the linear equations, became diagonal in K space, which means every K was connected only to the same K. Okay. So, as soon as you go to enharmonic terms, okay, if you start adding enharmonic terms, you will find that the phonon at momentum K starts interacting and you can go over to K prime. Okay, so because of the scattering with other phonons, the there could be, you know, processes like this. So let's say two phonons come together, there is some scattering amplitude for phonons to come in, there is a K1, K2, and there is an exchange here of momentum Q, and you would get K1 plus Q and K2 minus Q. Okay, so there is a conservation of momentum. But what this kind of a process will mean is that the phonon with momentum K1 does not have a definite energy. Okay. In fact, what happens is, in these kind of systems where there is a scattering of phonons, you start seeing something called a self energy. Okay. And instead of dealing with pure dispersions like these, you start dealing with something called Green's functions. Okay, so we can't deal this is not a single normal mode problem anymore. These normal modes are useful as an eigenbasis. You can take the entire wave function and write them as a linear superposition of the individual normal mode eigenfunctions. But when you go to a many body interacting system, like the system with anharmonic interactions, then these normal modes are not the normal modes of the interacting system. Okay, these normal modes then get modified heavily. In fact, they get something called a damping time, and it's easy to understand. So, sir, if you, yeah. Okay, yeah. So all we are saying is, let's say there are two phonons which are interacting with each other, right? Then the K1 phonon and K2 phonon, they are interacting with each other, and there is a transfer of momentum Q. Okay, then the outgoing phonons, one of them will have a K1 plus Q, and the outgoing other phonon will have a K2 minus Q. Okay. This is in the case when you have enharmonic terms. Now, in the case of harmonic terms, these processes do not arise. In the case of harmonic terms, there is absolutely no interaction between the normal modes. The normal modes behave like completely independent, non-interacting particles. It's like having a Fermi gas. Yeah?
What is Q?
Q is the momentum that is exchanged between these two. And there is a whole probability of what values the Q can take. So this diagram is not a simple diagram. You will have summation over all the internal indices. There would be time also here. And there would be an amplitude for this scattering also, and so on. And the amplitude for this scattering goes to zero in the harmonic case. Okay. So if you had a purely harmonic crystal, the normal modes would behave like non-interacting particles, non-interacting bosonic particles. Okay. But as soon as you put in enharmonic terms, you get a interacting bosonic system. And in the case of an interacting bosonic system, you would not be, I mean, these normal modes will not remain quasi-particle like. They will not behave like particles anymore, in the sense of having a definite energy and the momentum relationship. Okay. And it's easy to see why that is the case. So suppose if you had non-interacting phonons, and each phonon had a specific K and a specific energy. Now, as soon as it interacts with another phonon, right, then what would happen is that a different K state would get populated, which means that the original K state that you started with now has a finite lifetime, because the original phonon has decayed or has transferred to a different K state. So a different K state has got populated, and the original K state has got depopulated, which means, depending on the frequency of collision between phonons, there will be a certain relaxation time for the phonons, or a damping rate. Okay, and because of that, the particle nature of the system is not true anymore. Particle, if it was a true particle, it would remain a particle. Okay, it's not going to decay. We are not talking about particle physics, right? So this would remain a particle and it would retain its energy and momentum, but that is not what is happening. So this is exactly what happens in an interacting system, where the particle nature of, even in electronic systems, this happens, that the particles become something called quasi-particles. And then in many systems, you don't even see quasi-particles. They become fractionalized excitations when it's a strongly interacting system. And the same thing happens in phonons also. Okay, so there is an interesting work that I would like to point out in this context. Let me see if I can find it. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so can you see this? This is a paper, yes, that has appeared in 2019. It's a very recent paper. And normally we say that phonons are massless and you know, you can create and destroy phonons at will, which is why the they're bosonic.
My network
and so
is
the chemical potential is zero. Yeah? Sorry? Krishna, can you see this? Hello? So I'm just trying to point out that there is this paper that appeared in PRL. This is a very respectable journal, highly respectable journal. It appeared in 2019. And what it says is that sound waves are not massless, right? Sound waves actually carry gravitational mass. So it's an interesting paper. Now I have forgotten whether this is relevant to what we are discussing now in terms of the particle nature and the wave nature. But anyway, you guys can take a look at this. And you can also let me know what they're discussing. So Krishna, is that, is it clear why these are particles? I mean, they move independently. They have a fixed energy. They have a fixed, they have a fixed energy momentum relationship. So, and if they are moving completely independently of each other, then they are eigenmodes, okay? And that's how you can interpret them as particles and call them phonons, okay?
Sir.
Is this clear to everyone? Does anyone have doubts?
Yes, sir, I have a question.
Yes.
Sir, you said that phonons, corresponding to various normal modes, interact with each other.
Interact with each other. Oh. Only in a case where the potential has anharmonic terms. Yeah.
So, sir, if we can think the normal mode to be the vibration of a crystal, when all the atoms are vibrating with same frequency.
That's correct.
And so, the total vibration can be pictured as a phonon.
When all of them are vibrating with exactly the same frequency, yes.
So, sir, how can two normal modes interact at the same time?
See, it's not an easy thing to visualize. Definitely not. Okay. So what happens is, let's say you take you can visualize this better using a much more simpler system. Take a coupled oscillator system. Okay, in a coupled oscillator system, what you can do is you can start the oscillation of one of the oscillators. Okay, there are many YouTube videos on this. So you oscillate one of the oscillators, and then slowly you will see that there is an oscillation of energy between the two oscillators. Okay. The same thing happens if you had three oscillators also, that you start oscillating one of the oscillators and then there is a transfer of energy between all the three oscillators. Now, why do I say that this is actually a superposition of normal modes? See, what you did was you started with vibrating only one of them. Okay. And slowly the others also started vibrating. Now, the entire system's vibration can be described as, let me write this, okay. Okay, so let's say you have a string, okay, or you have a lattice, for example, and you selectively excite or you perturb only one of the atoms, okay, and then slowly you find that the entire system has started vibrating. But surely the entire system is not vibrating with a single frequency. So if you describe the un of t, okay, you should be able to describe that as a linear superposition of the different normal modes in the crystal. This is exactly what I think Shovik was pointing out, that we can write this as a Fourier series of ak e to the power I kna minus omega t. Now, do you see here that this omega and this k are actually related for a normal mode? Okay, so especially for this 1D chain with periodic boundary conditions, this omega k is proportional to mod sine ka by 2. Okay, now what we are saying here is that any un of t can be expressed as a linear superposition of each of the normal modes. And if you excite only one normal mode, then only one of those AKs is non-zero and all the other AKs will be zero. But any general vibration of the crystal can be expressed as a linear superposition of all the normal modes that could be excited in the system. Do you see my point?
Yes, sir.
Okay, this is very similar to, you know, what you could do for any general function also. If you have a periodic function, right, which is periodic in, let's say, time and space, then you could write it as a Fourier series. It's periodic in time because it is oscillatory, and it is periodic in space because you have applied periodic boundary conditions in space. So if you have a periodic boundary, if you have a periodic function in time and space, you can write it as a Fourier series. And the terms in the Fourier series turn out to be the normal modes of your system. Okay, so again, nothing quantum mechanical, just the Fourier series itself tells you that there have to be normal modes in the system. Is that clear?
Okay, so but I would try to point out this is not
a single normal mode. Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Okay. So for any general vibration, you would have AK as a function of K. If it turns out to be non-zero only for one particular K, then this is one normal mode. You have been able to excite only one normal mode. Okay. But in general, for any thermal vibration, for example, you would get all sorts of things. The AK would be non-zero not only for the acoustic modes but also for the higher modes. The acoustic modes would definitely get populated. And in this case, the omega k's, the distribution of the normal modes, is determined by the Bose-Einstein distribution function. Correct? And if you go to higher temperatures, then it will be just the Maxwell-Boltzmann, because Bose-Einstein reduces to the Maxwell-Boltzmann. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Any thermal vibration will not be a single normal mode, definitely. And this is what I was saying earlier also, that if you do a mechanical perturbation to any crystal, then it's extremely difficult to excite one normal mode. Generally, a whole distribution of normal modes will get excited. Okay? But it is much easier to do this for molecules, because molecules have well-separated normal modes, well separated in energy, so you can specifically excite one of those normal modes using resonant light, okay, using resonant optical frequencies. You can, you know, cause transitions and things like that. Is that clear?
Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
All right, so so if I now go back to this expression, omega k is 2 root k by m sine k a by 2 mod, and then I want to plot this as a function of k, okay, from minus pi by a to pi by a. Then because of this mod, the omega k is always positive, and for k tending to 0, this is linear in k, so this will be linear here. And as you go towards k equal to pi, you can see that this is going to be sine pi by 2, right, which is where the function becomes flat. So this would look something like this, and here also it would be a mirror image. This is an even function. Okay, so these are called the acoustic modes.
Sir, hello sir.
Yes.
Sir, is that because we are taking the thermodynamic limit, we have a continuous k?
Absolutely. Yeah, because you remember the values that k could take were given by 2 pi. So the values that k could take were 2 pi m by n, right? Now, the difference between two k's, the delta k is given by 2 pi by a times n, right? And this delta k will be extremely small only when n tends to infinity. So the k becomes a continuum only in the thermodynamic limit. Okay, and there were many other things also that we have glossed over. And if you had a finite system, you can still find the normal modes. And for any finite system, there would be a finite delta k, because if n is finite, then delta k is finite. Only when n tends to infinity, that delta k tends to zero, and that is when you can take the continuum limit.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Okay, sir.
And that is when we can say that all the k values which are here, right? For every k value, we have one normal mode. For this k value, we have this normal mode, right? But for molecules or for finite systems, this would not be the case. There would be only certain normal modes, and they would have certain wavelengths associated with them, okay, or certain frequencies associated with them, right? So so this is what the dispersion looks like, and if you see the maximum value possible, then this is only at k equal to pi by 2, and that would be 2 root k by m. Okay, so this value is important to remember, because what we will see next is that as soon as you go to a 1D crystal with a 2 atom basis, then this picture will change. Okay, now what we saw overall is that a 1D crystal with a monoatomic basis has n normal modes. So how do we argue for this? So go back to Newton's equations, and Newton's equations tell you that if there are n atoms which can move only in one dimension, okay, then you will have n equations to solve. If I take a 1D crystal but allow all the atoms to move in three dimensions, so this would be a very different situation. Okay, so what I am saying is that these atoms here, not only can they vibrate in this direction, they could also vibrate in this direction, and they could also vibrate in this direction. Then I am ascribing 3 degrees of freedom to every atom in this crystal. And then I would not have n equations, I would actually have 3n equations. The reason I would have 3n equations is because the un will have three components, the unx, the uny, and the unz. And each of these will get coupled to the other xyz components of the nearest neighbors, which means I would have to write 3n equations. And for the 3n equations, I would get 3n normal modes, simply because I would get a 3n by 3n matrix. Okay, so the number of equations that you have to solve determines the number of normal modes you will have in the system. It's as straightforward as that, right? So if I had a purely 1D system with only 1 degree of freedom, then I have n equations. Similarly, if I go now to a 2D system and say that every atom in that crystal can only vibrate in a plane, then if there are n atoms, then each atom has 2 degrees of freedom in the xy plane, for example. Then I would get 2n equations, and that would become 2n normal modes. Okay, but what would happen if I had a 1D crystal with a diatomic basis? So what does a diatomic basis mean? It means that I have a unit cell which has 2 atoms, and this 2-atom unit cell is repeating. So this is the picture that I'm thinking of. Now here, in n unit cells, if I had n unit cells, it would mean there are 2n atoms. And the spring constant, which is intra-unit cell and the inter-unit cell spring, could be different. Correct? So this could be, for example, A, B, and this could be A, B, and so on. And the A, B could be connected within the cell with a certain spring, and the BA, the intra-unit cell, the inter-unit cell, could be connected with a different spring constant. So this could be K1 and this could be K2, for example. In such a case, you would have to solve 2n equations because there are 2n atoms. Okay, so 2n atoms means there are 2n equations. And this would mean 2n normal modes. Okay. Now, these are the
normal. Sir, I did not understand this.
Okay, you did not understand. Fine. So, let's go back to this example, the 1D crystal with 3 degrees
sir,
of freedom.
A and B are 2 types of crystal. So, A and B are connected.
No, wait. A and B are not 2 types of crystal. What I did here was to draw again a chain. Okay. And in that chain, there is A, there is B. Then again, there is A, there is B, and so on. That's all. So imagine a 1D NaCl crystal, okay? As a physicist, you should be able to imagine it. I mean, don't tell this to a chemist, but as a physicist, imagine a NaCl crystal, which is 1D with NaCl, NaCl, and so on, okay? Or better, you could think of a polymer, okay? In a polymer, you have a monomer unit, and that monomer unit is connected to other monomer units. And inside each monomer, there are several atoms which are connected to each other. So this is the picture that I'm talking about. Is this clear? Is the picture clear?
Yes, sir. Okay. Sir, actually, internet.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. So in this case, we have, let's say if we have n unit cells, then for every unit cell, there are 2 atoms, which means there are 2n atoms in total. And there would be 2n equations to solve. Okay. Which means that there are 2n normal modes. And similarly, you can generalize this for any dimension and any number of atoms in the basis. So if you had 3 dimensions and NB basis atoms, okay, and N unit cells, then you would have to multiply all of these to get the number of normal modes. 3 times NB times N. However, this is not the same as the number of branches. Okay. The number of branches is, in this particular case, it's only 1 branch. What do I mean by branch here? A branch is how many dispersion relations can you get like this? Which means for each K, how many bands are you getting? So a branch in the phonon case is like the band in the electron case. For every momentum K, there are multiple bands that you can get in the electronic case. In the phonon case, for every K, how many omega K values can you get? So for this K, for example, I have only 1 value here, which is why I have only 1 branch. If I had a different branch, then for every K, I would have 2 values. Then I would call this as a 2-branch system. Okay, but when can this second branch arise, right? This could be a branch, or this could be another branch, for example. There could be a 2+1 branch system also. There could be 3 branches. Now, when can multiple branches arise? If I am in 1 dimension, the only way another branch can arise is if I had a diatomic basis. Otherwise, there is no possibility. If I had a monatomic basis, there is no possibility to generate a second branch. Okay, and if I had three atoms in the basis, I would generate three branches. Okay, so it's the number of, it's the total number of normal modes divided by the number of unit cells that gives you the total number of branches that are possible in the system. Is this clear? And we will actually derive this. So we will go ahead and look at the diatomic basis crystal, 1D crystal, and derive both the branches. One is the acoustic branch and one is the optical branch. Is this argument clear? If it is not clear, let me know.
What is the formula?
Can you repeat your question?
What was the expression you said for determining the number of branches?
So if you see here, let's say I take a 1D crystal, right? And for a 1D crystal, I have two basis atoms. Okay, then I would have to solve 2n atom, 2n equations, correct? And there would be 2n normal modes. Okay, but there are only n unit cells, which means, remember, if you had only n unit cells, you will get only nk values. So n unit cells implies nk values, because the reason is because n unit cells means that the periodicity of the lattice is determined by n unit cells. And because you had n unit cells, if you go back to the periodicity condition, you will basically get k as this. So there are only n possible k values. Now, how will you divide 2n normal modes among nk values? For every k value, you have to have two energies, right? And if you had one k value but two energies for that, then it means that there is a second branch. Do you understand this? Okay. The number of normal modes, the number of total normal modes in the system divided by the number of k values gives you the number of branches. Okay?
Okay.
So if you had d dimensions, and d dimensions, by d dimensions, I mean the number of degrees of freedom in the d dimensions is equal to itself. Right? I mean, this was a special case where I said there is a one-dimensional system, but there are 3 degrees of freedom for each atom. Okay? So let's call the D as the degrees of freedom, right? In whatever dimension you are in. And then you multiply that by the number of basis atoms, right? So that gives you the number of branches. Okay?
Okay, sir. Yeah, it's fine.
Okay. So let's stop here and then we'll meet in the coming week, Wednesday. Yeah.
Sir, degree of freedom multiplied by the number of basis atoms gives the branches. So in one dimension, lattice is one dimension, and lattice point can move three dimensions, then the branches will be three.
Yes, three times. Yeah, if it's a monatomic basis, then it is just three. Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
I have a question.
Yes.
Sir, for 1D crystal with one atomic basis.
Can you speak up a little because I can't hear you?
Hello. Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Yeah, I can hear you, but the volume is very low. Yeah, just speak louder.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, for 1D with one atomic basis, we derived for long wavelength limit. So we got phase velocity is same as the group velocity.
That's correct.
For short wavelength limit, how the dimension change?
Yeah, you can see that. See, if you take the omega by k here, right? So if you take the short wavelength limit, then that is here, right? Near the Brillouin zone edge.
Right.
No, you're talking about short wavelength, which means large k, right? So if you take the Brillouin zone edge here, then you can see that the group velocity is zero because the slope is zero.
Okay.
correct?
Yes.
In fact, if you take this dispersion and find its density of states, you will find that this part is actually contributing to a Vano singularity. Because you can see that the derivative of the dispersion is going to zero here. Which is the same in the electronic case also. In the electronic band structure, if the gradient of the dispersion is zero at some point, then those k points contribute to Vano singularities. Okay, but you can see here that the omega by k is going to be very different. Why? Because if you take this as the omega, this is the y axis, and if you take this as the k, then omega by k is this, right? Which is the tan of this angle, theta, and that is something finite. So you can see that the phase velocity is finite and very well defined at the at short wavelengths, but the group velocity is going to zero. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
So
the energy of the phonons here is described by the omega k itself. The frequency and the energy are synonymous in this system. Okay, if you had non-interacting normal modes, then the energy and the frequency are synonymous. In an interacting system with enharmonic modes, with enharmonicity in the Hamiltonian, then the energy and the frequency, in fact, the frequency is not a well-defined term there at all. Okay, you have to say what is the energy of the, in fact, even a definite energy is not well-defined. Okay. You have to find out correlation functions and then look at the damping of the correlation functions. You have to look at the self energy. Then you have to look at vertex corrections and things like that. So in an interacting system, these concepts are valid only in restricted momentum zones. So it turns out that when you go to k tending to zero, for example, equivalently in an electronic system, when you are near the Fermi momentum, you can still define quasi-particles, which means phonons which behave almost like particles, which means their energy and momentum have a one-to-one correspondence. But if you are deep in the Brillouin zone anywhere, then this relationship would break down. This is in an anharmonic system, okay? Not in a harmonic system. Harmonic system, this is all well-defined. And in fact, the dispersion that we are drawing here, these lines, for example, in an interacting system, you would start seeing a width to this. Okay, these lines would get blurred. But there would be some regions of the Brillouin zone where again you would get very sharp features. So this blurriness would merge into a very sharp line, maybe close to k equal to zero. So some of the acoustic modes still retain their phonon or their particle nature, okay, their normal mode nature, because their damping rate would be extremely small. Their relaxation time would be extremely large, but not in general. In general, most normal modes would rapidly damp away because of scattering with other phonons. So again, I'm not sure whether I answered your question. You can repeat the question if you like. Okay, so what I am saying then is, suppose I tell you that in interacting systems, you can define an omega k, but it gets an imaginary part, something like this. Okay, if something like this happens, that it has both a real part and an imaginary part, then you can't draw these kind of figures. You can still say, let me take the real part of omega k and draw that as a function of k. You can say that. And then what you can do is the imaginary part, wherever there is an imaginary part, you can draw that as a width of this line. You understand what I'm saying? Let me explain, okay? See, suppose you had an interacting system, then what you would get for omega k will have both a real part, let me call that xk, okay? And then you would also have an imaginary part. In non-interacting systems, the yk would be zero. But in interacting systems, the yk is non-zero. So now what I can do is, I can plot the xk versus the k, and you would get well-defined branches. And I will take the yk and introduce that yk as a width of this, as a kind of an error bar. Okay, and this yk you would find goes on decreasing in some parts of the Brillouin zone. So you would see a kind of envelope like this. Do you see what I'm saying? It's not a single branch anymore. It's a thick branch. It's a branch with a certain width.
Okay, sir, I understood the difference because
and the same thing happens with this is nothing to do with temperature, by the way. Even with temperature, you could have a non-interacting system and well-defined branches. Branches has nothing to do with temperature. Branches are the normal modes of a system, and that you can draw at any temperature. It's the occupancy of the modes which depends on temperature. Now, if you had an anharmonic system, then even at zero temperature, the normal modes are not normal modes anymore. The normal modes will get some damping, will get damped. Each normal mode will have some relaxation time or a relaxation rate. Okay, nothing to do with temperature. That is something that I want to make it clear. Is that fine?
Excuse me, sir. Can you hear me?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Sorry?
Hello? Can you hear me?
Yeah, can you ask me? Yes, I can hear you.
Sir, as you told, add plus minus pi by a, VG is equal to 0. So we can say that now wave behave like standing wave. And there is no transfer of energy or signal.
Okay.
So also at this point, lambda will be exactly equal to 2 h. So it is like we are driving the black slope from there.
It's like what, sorry?
It is like the black slope we have lambda is equal to 2 sine theta. So we can say that at this condition we can actually derive black slope.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, this is again going from real space to reciprocal space, but just for phonons, for lattice vibrations. This is what we did for the usual crystal planes also. So, yes, I agree with you. It's like the phase velocity has gone to zero and it's basically a standing wave. It's not a propagating wave. Whereas the acoustic modes are propagating, they have a definite velocity. And they would carry energy
right,
also.
Right.
So that is basically sound.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Okay, so we'll meet each other on Wednesday. And meanwhile, I will send an assignment also. Basically, the assignment is first two chapters of Kittel, the exercises. Yes. Yes.
Sir, I have the examination in 1357 October. So I was just to mail you today about the assignment. So if you can delay this, because I have to appear for the examination. So the date hasn't confirmed yesterday. So I was just to mail you about this.
Shovik. Okay. When is the exam?
1st October, 3rd October, 5th October, 7th October.
I see.
And 26th of September, and maybe 11 or 12.
Okay,
October.
Then we'll do one thing. Let's not have an assignment, let's have a test. Let's all. We will also have a test then. So I'm joking. So yeah, we can delay the assignment. That's not a problem. We can say that you can
submit
the assignment maybe on like 10th of October or something.
Okay, sir. I was just to say that extend the deadline of the submitting the assignment.
That's what I said. That's what I did.